de schrijfster Leila S. Chudori interviewen over haar boek waarmee ze prijzen heeft gewonnen, Pulang. Het is Engelstalig, heb ik begrepen. En Jos Wibisono zal de schrijfster vooral vragen stellen over de stilistische en literaire aspecten van Pulang. En Pulang betekent naar huis. Ik geef heel graag het woord aan Jos Wibisono en zijn gast Leila S. Chudori.
Dames en heren, verbanning, waardoor mensen gedwongen zijn hun geboorteland te verlaten, gebeurde niet alleen tijdens de decolonisatie van Indonesië. Toen Indonesië eenmaal merdeka werd, waren er ook mensen die verbannen werden. Het gebeurde ten tijde van de machtswisseling tussen Sukarno en Suharto in 1965. Althans, ze konden niet huiswaarts keren toen generaal Suharto de macht in handen kreeg. Met de uitbreiding van alles wat naar links rook, werd hun eigen land te gevaarlijk voor de Indonesiërs die toentertijd in het buitenland verbleven. Ze waren gedwongen zich in het buitenland te vestigen, in Europa, elders in Azië of zelfs in Afrika en Latijns-Amerika, als asielzoeker of staatloos. Over deze bandelingen, ze noemden zich Golongan Exil, gaat het volgende gesprek. Want we hebben hier Leila Saliha Chudori, schrijfster van Pulang. Pulang. Een roman die haar fijn het leven van Indonesische bandelingen in Parijs beschrijft. Het verrassende van Pulang is dat het niet alleen het begin van Suharto's nieuwe orde behandelt, maar het ook over het einde daarvan gaat, waar wederom met veel bloedvergieten gepaard ging. Het is Leila Chudori gelukt Indonesië onder Suharto in zijn complexiteit te portretteren, maar daarbij ook de schijnheiligheid en oppervlakkigheid van de machthebbers bloot te leggen. En omdat anders dan in Suriname het Nederlands in Nederlands-Indië geen voertaal was, met als gevolg dat vrijwel niemand van de huidige generatie in Indonesië nog Nederlands spreekt, gaan we ons gesprek in het Engels voeren. Maar eerst verzoek ik Leslie Boon de proloog van Pulang voor te lezen. Mochten er onder u mensen zijn die het Indonesisch niet machtig zijn, dan kunt u de vertaling meelezen die achter op het scherm zal verschijnen. Het boek wordt nu, as we speak, in het Nederlands vertaald en wordt volgend jaar door uitgeverij de Geus uitgegeven. De vertaler, professor Henk Maier, stemt toe dat we de eerste vruchten van zijn werk vandaag gebruiken. Leslie.
Jalan Sabang, Jakarta, April 1968. Malam sudah turun tanpa kerutu dan tanpa siasat. Seperti jala hitam yang mengepung kota, seperti tinta yang ditumpahkan seekor cumi raksasa ke seluruh permukaan Jakarta. Seperti juga warna masa depan yang tak bisa diraba. Di dalam kamar gelap ini, aku tak mengenal matahari, bulan, atau arwuji. Tetapi kegelapan yang mengepung ruangan ini penuh dengan aroma bahan kimia dan rasa cemas. Sudah 3 tahun kantor berita Nusantara, tempatku bekerja, dibersihkan dari kutu dan debu seperti kami. Tentara adalah disinfektan. Kami, kutu dan debu yang harus dibersihkan dari muka bumi, tanpa bekas. Kini sang kutu mencari nafkah di cahaya foto di pojok Jalan Sabang. Aku menyalakan lampu merah untuk mengecek beberapa film yang tengah digantung. Mungkin ini sudah jam 6, karena aku bisa mendengar sayup suara ajan maghrib yang menyelip melalui kisi pintu. Aku membayangkan suasana sepanjang Jalan Sabang. Suara bemo yang cerewet, oplet yang bergerak dengan malas, derit becak dan kelenengan sepeda yang simpang siur menyeberang, serta penjual roti yang menyerukan dagangannya. Aku bahkan bisa membayangkan betapa angin meniup aroma sate kambing yang dibakar Pak Heri di pojok Jalan Sabang dan Asem Lama. Aku yakin, dia tengah mengulek kacang tanah lalu mencampurnya dengan kecap manis dan irisan bawang merah. Dan aku masih ingat betapa sahabatku Dimas Suryo akan mempelajari dan membahas bumbu kacang tanah Pak Heri dengan intens, sama seperti dia membicarakan bait-bait puisi Rifa Abil. Semua kerewalan di luar itu biasanya ditutup dengan bunyi siuran gerobak Suhadi, penjual kue putu langganan kami yang senantiasa berhenti di depan cahaya foto. Selain aroma sate kami Pak Heri, suara siulan itu yang bisa menembus memasuki kamar gelap. Biasanya kamar gelap ini mengalihkan suara-suara melalui warna hitam yang mematikan. Tetapi bunyi dan aroma kue putu itu selalu berhasil mengetuk pintu dan jendela. Itu pertanda aku harus keluar dari ruangan yang tak mengenal waktu ini. Hari ini, entah mengapa, aku enggan melangkah keluar. Aku sudah bisa membayangkan ruangan di luar tampak seperti dunia yang muram. Lampu neon yang menyiram lantai dan lemari kaca, Suharjo dan Liang yang meladeni pengunjung yang mengambil hasil cetak foto dan memotret pas foto. Yang belakangan ini adalah sumber mata pencaharian kami yang tertinggi sejak 2 tahun lalu. Hampir setiap hari paling tidak ada 10-15 orang yang harus membuat surat keterangan tidak terlibat gerakan 30 September yang butuh pas foto. Bunyi siulan dan gerobak kue putu itu masih memanggil-manggil. Aku masih juga belum bergerak. Aku merasa bunyi siulan itu bercampur dengan siul seorang lelaki. Perlahan-lahan ku dengar langkah tegap yang memasuki toko kami. Kini aku tak tahu mana yang lebih ribut, siulan gerobak kue putu atau debak jantungku. Selamat malam, Pak. Selamat malam, suara Pak Adi Cahyono, pemilik toko cahaya foto. Bisa bertemu dengan Pak Ananto? Aku tidak mendengar jawaban Adi. Aku membayangkan dia agak curiga. Aku menduga tamunya berjumlah 3 orang, atau mungkin mereka berempat. Boleh saya tahu siapakah kalian? Saya saudara sepupunya dari Jawa Tengah, terdengar suara lain yang lebih halus dan terpelajar. Adi terdiam. Aku tahu, Adi Cahyono terpaksa takluk pada kehalusan dan tata krama lelaki yang mengaku sepupunya dari Jawa Tengah itu. Tapi aku tidak mendengar apapun. Aku membayangkan dia mencoba berpikir berlama-lama. Hananto Prawiro, Pak, terdengar suara lain yang lebih berat dan menekan. Seolah-olah jika Adi Cahyono menggunakan taktik mengingat-ingat, si suara berat itu akan segera mendekat dan mencekiknya. Di dalam kamar gelap, aku berdiri tidak bergerak dan tak juga merancang siasat. Aku masih mendengar siulan gerobak putu yang kini seperti memainkan nirwana dari lato. Mengapa bukan bolero, aku tak paham. Mungkin nirwana selalu berhasil menjalani rasa sentimentalitas. Kamar gelap tak memiliki jendela. Jadi kalaupun aku ingin menyelinap keluar dan lari, aku harus menggunakan pintu. Dan itu berarti secepat apapun langkahku, mereka akan mengepungku dari segala arah. Tetapi aku sudah tidak berminat hidup dalam perburuan. Bukan karena kehidupan yang tak nikmat dan melarat, bukan pula karena aku sudah kehilangan gelora perlawanan. Tetapi kabar yang terakhir kuterima, Surti dan anak-anak sudah dipindahkan dari Guntur dan Budi Kemuliaan. Pada satu titik aku harus berhenti. Bukan karena aku tak percaya lagi pada perjuangan, tetapi aku ingin Surti dan ketiga anakku bisa hidup aman. Paling tidak aku beruntung mereka selama 3 tahun hidup dalam perburuan. terdengar dari pintu. Kenapa aku selalu saja lupa meminyaki asal itu? Suara Adi menyampaikan kedatangan sepupu dari Jawa Tengah, tergerus oleh siolan berubah kutu. Aku tak terlalu mendengar pernyataannya, tapi aku tahu isinya. Aku harus menyerahkan diri. Kami saling memandang. Aku bisa melihat air mata yang mengambang di pelupuk mata Adi. Aku tahu dia tak berdaya. Aku mengangguk dan mengambil jaketku. Hari ini, tanggal 6 April 1968. Kulirik lenganku, aku ingat. Arlojiku sudah kuberikan kepada Dimas. Kudengar dia, Nuk dan Rishaf sedang bersembunyi di Peking. Titeni, 17 jewels itu mungkin akan membantunya lebih tepat waktu. Aku hanya mengamati warna pergelangan tanganku yang belang. Keempat tamu dari Jawa Tengah itu langsung menyambut kedatanganku. Dan entah bagaimana, keempatnya serentak berdiri mengelilingiku dengan tangan terselip di balik jaket. Tepatnya, mereka mengepungku sembari bersiap menembak jika aku menyelinap dan lari. Salah satu dari mereka, mungkin pemimpinnya, menghampiriku. Bapak Hanato, saya Letu Mukijo, dia tersenyum. Ah, dialah yang bersuara sopan dan penuh tata krama tadi. Kini aku bisa melihat matanya yang bercahaya. Dia tersenyum puas. Dan senyumnya itu selintas aku menangkap silau gigi emas yang menyeruak melalui bibirnya. Aku tahu dia puas karena aku adalah butir terakhir rangkaian yang mereka bunuh. Ratusan teman-temanku sudah mereka tangkap sejak perburuan yang dimulai 3 tahun lalu. Mari ikut kami. Letu Mukijo sungguh berada, padahal aku sudah siap digelandang dan ditendang kanan kiri. Menurut kabar kawan-kawan, mereka penasaran sekali mencari aku hingga menyebutku sambayang-bayang. Aku mengangguk dengan tenang dan melangkah diiringi keempat lelaki berbaju sipil yang pamit pada Adi Cahyono. Malam telah turun, tanpa berutu dan tanpa siasat. Aku mengamati mereka menghampiri 2 buah mobil yang diparkir di depan cahaya foto, Nissan Patrol dan Toyota Canvas. Leila Mukijo, pemilik gigi emas, mempersilahkan aku menumpang jeep Toyota Canvas. Aku membayangkan wajah Surti, kenangan, bulan dan alam. Dan entah mengapa, dari seluruh kawan-kawanku, hanyalah wajah Dimas Suryo yang terus-menerus mengikutiku. Ketika mesin mobil dinyalakan, aku menebarkan pandangan ke seluruh malam di Jalan Sabang. Gerobak kue putu Suhardi, sate Pak Heri, warung bami godok, dan terakhir lampu neon cahaya foto yang berkelap kulit untuk terakhir kalinya.
Leila, I was telling the audience that your novel is about Indonesian exile in Paris. Why do you choose Indonesian exile in Paris?
Thank you. Good evening or good afternoon. actually, it's not only about Indonesian exiles in Paris. Mm-hmm. The novel is almost 500 pages in Bahasa Indonesia. So I don't know, in Dutch language it's going to be how long. But it's divided by 3 big chapters. And the first chapter, only the first chapters are in Paris. It's talking about the exiles in Paris. The second chapter is the second generation. And then the third chapter is in Indonesia in 98. So it started from 65 and then it ends in 98. So if one asks what the novel is about, I wouldn't say it's only about the exiles. It's about 2 generations in Indonesia. And it started from the, you know, Indonesian tragedy in 65 that resulted some Indonesian or a lot of Indonesians who couldn't go home. Because some of them were students, some of them were diplomats, some of them were journalists who were abroad in the 60s. And then because 65 erupted and then they couldn't go home because they were considered either they are part of the Communist Party or they are leftist.
Mm.
And then, you know, some of them live in China and then they move around in Europe, and maybe, as you may know, a lot of them live in Holland. A lot of them also live in France, Eastern Europe, Russia, and also China. So these are the people that I was talking about, but I focus mainly the ones in Paris, and then also about the second generation who didn't know Indonesia as their motherland or their tanah air.
But why do you choose them as a...
Why do I choose the people in Paris instead of Holland? Or,
yes.
or just exile?
Why do you choose exile in...
Exactly.
Yeah.
No, like I said, I didn't just choose exile. I choose Indonesian history 65 as a background. But my interest is more about family. I didn't particularly want to say that I'm writing about exile. I'm writing about
family.
Yeah.
And yet still it's... on Indonesian living in France, not in Indonesia itself.
No, like I said in chapter three, if you remember, I also talk about families in Indonesia. The chapter of Keluarga Wibisono is Indonesian family in Indonesia.
Okay,
yes.
But because we are also dealing with a lot of people who were displaced.
Yes.
When it happened, you know, when something big political happened.
Mm-hmm.
And it attracts you to write something on them. Not, for instance, if I put a contrast with another writer in Indonesia, which is Laksmi Pamuja.
Mm-hmm.
Laksmi wrote about people in Buru,
mm-hmm.
and you choose people in exile. So,
one third of the novel.
Why not Guru? Why not those who really were communists, who really
killed? Well, Guru was already written by Laksmi, right?
So yes.
No, like I said, I'm sorry, I feel that I'm repeating myself.
Okay.
I'm interested in writing about families.
Okay.
That's my thing. My previous story, my previous work, and my next work is also going to be families. So I really don't know how to answer your question.
It doesn't matter where they stay.
It doesn't matter where the location is.
Okay.
My stories are going to be about families.
Okay.
So my previous story is also about families, which happened that they live in Holland. Maybe you're going to mention that later on, which is this one. That's families that who. Indonesian family who met in Holland and got married and they went back home. But this one just happened that they are in Paris, you know?
Right.
But it's still Indonesian family that couldn't go home because their passport were taken away. They couldn't go home, and they actually couldn't move around easily. You know? So they were really living in a very difficult position. But if you notice, I also talk about the families in Indonesia who were terrorized. They are the families of the Indonesian couple, Indonesian
political prisoners,
or anybody who were related to Indonesian Communist Party. All the families were very, very terrorized.
Right.
They were arrested, they were raped, they were, you know, so... If you really, really notice, like I was talking in three big chapters, it's talking about all these families, not only the exile people.
Yeah. So, it's family, not only exile people, but who are they? Are they communists or are they just victims of
the
order?
The one in the stories? Or
yes.
The
one in the stories, yes.
Well,
who are they?
Actually, I should say maybe the audience. Some of them haven't read the book.
Mm-hmm.
When I wrote this, I was interested to write about this because I met the Indonesian exile in Paris who built a corporation, Restaurant Indonesia, in Paris, the late Bapak Umar Said and the late Sultan Aidit.
Yes.
Yeah. And the reason why I was interested, because I came back home from 6 years in Canada studying, and then, you know, my generation is a generation of new order. Like, we only understand and we only learn that communism is something bad, you know, because we only learn history from the government version.
Right.
You see? And, you know, so I went going back from Canada in the 80s, I stopped by in Europe, including I went to Amsterdam, I went to Paris, and then that was the first time I met them. And Restaurant Indonesia in Paris was built up 4 years. So they were, you know, in the very beginning, they were very excited. And I didn't know that there were people, English people, who were treated that way. You know, so that was my first, first meeting with the absurdity of Indonesian politics. And then you know, I went back home, and my father was a journalist, and you know, he used to live in Holland for a while. He was posted here, and I asked about what is this? Like, what? How come there are so many exiles who couldn't go home? And then so my father told me the story, and then so he told me the you know, the whole bit. And you know, I was also talking about the history. How come that we only learn, you know, this version, you
yes.
know, like about six generals who were killed and the communists, you know, and then all the monuments and the movies that, you know, people have to watch every year as a propaganda. So that was my first touch with this, the people, the exile people. And then later on, when I worked in Tempo magazine, then I became more and more interested because there were people who were Buru Island
yes.
people who were work in Tempo,
in Tempo,
and also the children of the Communist Party who work in Tempo, but because that was in the 80s, so Suharto was still the president, they couldn't, they worked, but they couldn't have their names, published, you know. So they have to have a different name. They have to have use an alias.
Right.
So that's another absurdity. I thought, what was going on here? So apparently there was a policy. It's Brazilian versus Lingkungan. I don't know if you should translate that. But
I think it's similar to when the Nazi came to power, that you have to declare yourself that you are Aryan.
Okay.
I mean, but this is on Suharto's side.
Yeah.
This
yeah.
is the same.
So it's. You, if you were involved in communist, you're involved in Communist Party, or if you're the family of the Communist Party, then you know you're not allowed to work as a journalist, as a teacher, as a dalang, as a pastor, anything that has something to do with public.
Right.
Yeah. So then you're not allowed, and of course you're not allowed to be a civil servant.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, you can't do anything then. Right? So a lot of the ex-tapo usually work with a different name.
Different names,
yeah?
Yes.
So, and then I thought that was becoming, so that's why I kind of insist that I wasn't writing only about the exile, but also about the family of the tapo in Indonesia, because
yes.
their wives are really, really, were really suppressed by the government.
Mm.
So when you ask, who are these people? Well, a lot of them were Lekra people, yeah.
Yes.
Lekra
means the organization of the Indonesian leftist artists back in 1960s when Soekarno was in power.
Yes.
Right.
And they usually are, they're considered close to the Communist Party.
Yes.
They're not a part of the Communist Party, but they are considered close to the Communist Party. So. The people that I'm talking about here, some of them are journalists who couldn't get back home because they're considered leftists,
yeah.
and some of them are Lekra people.
Mm-hmm.
And the protagonist, the main character actually, is someone who's actually very, gray. He's in the gray area. Like he's close to the leftist people, but he's also close to the rights people.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, he's with everybody, but then, you know, he's one of those who couldn't go back home.
You're right when you said about writing a family.
Yeah.
But there is also the families are not they're not only the victims of New Order.
Yeah.
But there are also families who adore New Order.
Yes.
Why do you need to portray that?
Because I need to portray Actually, some people criticized that I didn't portray enough the new order side.
Yes.
And I said, no, I did. But that's too. But now you're asking the other way around. I need to give a little bit of that.
Yes.
Because from all the whole chapter, if you notice, actually I was writing 90% about the victim.
Mm.
Yeah. But I also need to put a little bit of that so people know how they are, you know. And I also need to put that as a contrast, because this novel is based on a lot of research and interviews. I interview many, many, many people. I don't know, 30 or 40 people, you know, the families, some historians, and a lot of books I interview. And some of the families that I interview told me that, yeah, some of their uncles or aunt married a tatara, you know, military people, and you know, and she was from the left, you know, and then I said, my God, so what happened? And, oh, it was a big deal, you know, and that happens, like someone married the tatara or someone married, you know, someone from the new order. And in fact, there was the son of a very high position in the Communist Party was dating the son of the from the police. This is a true story.
Right.
It was like a Romeo and Juliet thing, you know, like two families, really different ideology, and it really ended badly, you know, like this real story. So because it happened, so of course I had to talk about that, where in some of the characters, he was dating someone from the other side.
Okay.
So.
Let's continue. Ask Leslie again to cite another part of your book.
Jakarta. Agustus 1968. Mas Dimas, Mas Hananto terjaring oleh 4 orang intel bulan April lalu. Kami mendapat kabar ini dari Pak Adi Cahyono. Kami tak tahu kemana mereka membawa Mas Hananto. Mungkin dia dibawa ke Guntur. Tapi ada juga yang memberi informasi dia dibawa ke Gunung Sahari 4. Kami belum mendengar kabar apapun dari dia. Mbak Surti, yang sejak peristiwa 65 terus menerus diinterogasi di Guntur, kini juga dibawa, Mas. Dia tak mau meninggalkan kenangan, Pulang, dan Alam. Alam adalah putra bungsu Mas Hananto yang baru berusia 3 tahun. Akhirnya 3 anak itu dibawa bersama Mbak Surti ke Jalan Budi Kemuliaan. Kenangan menyaksikan hal-hal yang rasanya terlalu keji untuk anak usia 14 tahun. Bayangkan bagaimana pula nasib kedua adiknya. Bulan yang masih berusia 6 tahun, dan Alam yang masih kecil sekali. Ini aku sertakan surat dari Kenanga untukmu. Menurut Kenanga, Mas Hananto pernah berpesan bahwa Mas Dimas adalah ayah kedua bagi mereka. Aku tak kuat membacanya, Mas. Sekali lagi ibu menekankan sebaiknya Mas Dimas tetap di Eropa saja. Kami sudah merasa lebih tenang di Jakarta. Perburuan semakin mengganas, bukan hanya pada mereka yang dianggap komunis atau ramah kepada PKI. Kini keluarga atau sanak famili pun kena ciduk. Ada yang dikembalikan, ada yang hilang begitu saja, ada yang dihanyutkan ke sungai. Kebetulan ibu dan aku hanya sempat dipanggil beberapa kali ke Guntur. Tetapi kami diperbolehkan pulang setelah seharian menjawab pertanyaan yang itu-itu aja. Kebanyakan pertanyaan mereka berkisar tentang kegiatan Mas Dimas dan apakah kami mengenal Mas Hananto, Mas Muk, Bung Jai, dan Bung Rishaf. Mereka juga berkali-kali bertanya apa yang dilakukan Mas Dimas di Peding beberapa tahun lalu. Bahkan entah bagaimana, mereka tahu bahwa seharusnya yang berangkat ke Santiago, Havana, dan Peding adalah Mas Hananto. Saat interogasi, aku bisa mendengar suara teriakan orang-orang yang disiksa. Suara mereka melengking menembus langit-langit dan aku hanya bisa berharap cerita mereka tiba ke telinga Tuhan. Apa yang disaksikan didengar kenangan jauh lebih mengerikan, Mas. Bacalah suratnya dan tolong balas segera. Jakarta sudah menjadi neraka. Doakan kami. Adikmu, Aji Suryo.
Thank you, Alex. This is very groomed situation.
Yeah, I know.
How do you do that?
Actually, it was harder when I interviewed.
Yeah?
Yeah, because I have to admit it to the audience, the real thing was much harsher than the one that I wrote. I couldn't write as hard as the real thing because it was just too hard for me. Mm. For example, several people, including Henk Maier, who's translating it into Dutch, he asked me, why didn't you write the rape, you know, right? Because usually the female activists, the one or the wives of the communists or people who are related to communists, usually they're raped. And I said, yes, some of them were raped, a lot of them were raped, but usually when you're in the middle ranking party, or they would terrorize and harass. Yeah? But that's not really my reason. It's really because I just couldn't write something that is so hard. Yeah? The scene, if later on you read it, either in Dutch or in English or in Mass in Asia, the scene that I wrote is more harassed, yeah? Sexual harassed, yes. Rather than rape. But for me, it's both difficult. It was really, really difficult. But I have to admit, it was more difficult when I interviewed them. For me, the most difficult one is not this one, but the one that we got Nyoto's wife.
Nyoto is one of the leader of the Communist Party.
Party. So his wife was arrested, and the whole six children was brought into the interrogation office in Bulikumuyaan. And you know, that was the most difficult one because you know the oldest daughter has to clean all the blood from the people, and that's like a real thing. Like, that's not fiction. That was difficult to learn the truth.
But did you interview them yourself?
No. That was we made a special edition of Tempo.
Okay.
So I was one of the editors, and they had to go to interview many people. So I didn't interview myself, but I interviewed several other political prisoners.
Political prisoners. Yeah.
I interviewed the political prisoners. So.
You are editor of Tempo. This is the magazine, Tempo magazine. This is the English version, but Tempo was published, of course, in Indonesia. But perhaps this is going to be my last question. But then, no, we have to change first to another book of yours, which is this.
Yeah.
This book is already translated into English, The Longest Kiss. One of the stories, my favorite story, I must say, is the first one. It's about the search of the flowers. What's the English word for sarumi?
Chrysanthemum,
yes. So looking for the flower chrysanthemum.
There's a Dutch word for that, I
think. It takes place, one of the setting is Amsterdam.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, it is.
How is it for you to write something about Amsterdam?
That's difficult, especially having a friend like him. some of the things that in that story, it's a long short story. I should say it's like a novella because it's really, it's not a short story, but it's a long short story. Right?
Yes.
It starts from a suicide, but then it goes a flashback about the woman who committed suicide and how she met her husband and how she got married and have three kids.
It was in Amsterdam.
And then she met the husband to be. In Amsterdam, she studied here at Vrije University in 1956 or something. And then the husband also studied here, or the husband-to-be studied here, and they fell in love. And then they got married. But I think the main story was that they came from a totally different family. The man was from a very Islamic background, from the Santan, and he got a scholarship to come here. And what the protagonist, well, she's not the protagonist actually.
She is.
Yeah, but okay. She comes from a very rich family, from a businessman family, and PSP,
Socialist Party.
Indonesian Socialist Party.
Its leader was
a very secular family. So these two worlds kind of collide when they only realized it when they went back home, you know, and then, you know, then you meet the real family, you meet the real world. And then there is also the children, you know, the three kids. So that's why there's a little bit of the Amsterdam story.
How do you write this?
How? Well, because my parents were Dutch educated, like they studied here, and so I asked a lot of questions with them, and I have been to Amsterdam several times. So.
Okay, so you can picture Amsterdam.
Yeah, I tried, because it was in the 1950s, and I asked my father too. You know, and there are several places that he said it's not, hasn't changed yet.
Right, because I remember in the book you mentioned instead of today we call it Universiteit van Amsterdam UvA, but then you use the word GU, gemeentelijke universiteit. Nobody knows about it anymore today. But I mean, when I read the book, I said, "Oh my God, she knows about it."
Because of my father.
Because of your father.
Yeah, I asked really detailed about it. Okay, so what was your university again? And then he said, "Okay, now it's all this." And then, you know, he wrote it down, and then he said, "Oh, this one is it's considered a pink, a little bit leftist university." And, you know, so my dad was a journalist. So he really told me really detailed, because you know, he's a journalist, so, including all the weather and you know, the streets and I said, is it still the same? Because you know, I visited Amsterdam the first time in the 1980s. You know, so I said, do you still have that? Do you still have this? So that's and it happens that my dad was a bartender. You know, he was a student, but then you know, he worked part-time as a bartender, so I thought, oh, that's interesting, because, you know, he came from a pesantren, you know, from an Islamic school in Indonesia, and then, you know, he works as a bartender, so I said, did you ever drink? You know? Yeah. But, oh, yeah, I tried a little bit, you know, so it was interesting.
Okay, so your father was a journalist,
yeah,
and you yourself is also a journalist, and yet you write novels.
I wrote stories first before I became a journalist, actually.
Okay, so you must have a different approach in writing a journalistic report and in writing a novel, something, yes. You know, fictional, yes. And supposed to be literary.
Yes.
Could you just open slightly your kitchen? Mm-hmm. How, as a writer, how is it to write something journalistic, and how is it to write something literary? Yeah, literary.
Well, I actually started writing fiction before I became a journalist. You know, I became a journalist after I graduated. You know. But I stopped writing when I was a teenager. I was 12. You know, I stopped writing a children's story, and I stopped publishing when I was very young. So. Writing fiction came naturally, you know. I learned from a lot of people, a lot of senior writers that time. But you know, journalism was later on, you know. But again, because my father was a journalist, I understand that you know journalism has to deal with facts, you know. Whereas fiction, it's a combination of facts and imagination. You know, I've learned that since I was really young. And so, you know, when I decided, okay, I want to join, you know, journalism, I want to become a journalist, and my father's wisdom was only, if you want to start something, you have to go to a bigger place like Compass or Tempo or Reuters, you know, so you learn the structure, and afterwards if you want to start something new, that's fine.
Mm.
But you have to learn from the, you know, from the really beginning. You have to start from scratch, you have to become a reporter first.
Right.
Yeah? So and I said, oh, okay. So and then I after, you know, I apply here and there, I decided to join with them because I feel it fits with me, as you know, because I also like writing. And Tempo is it's a weekly magazine, and they usually prefer to write a story behind the news, like it's not hard news. Whereas my father was from Antara News Agency, that was you know, it's a news agency.
Yes, news agency.
Maybe it's similar, like an online.
Well, they have it here in Holland, like AMP.
Yeah, my dad started Antara here in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
So anyway, so the difference obviously is because you have to deal with facts as a journalist. You have to deal with facts, and you have to check and recheck all the time, verify. Especially Tempo after Reformation, after 98, after Suharto, the fall of Suharto, we are more doing investigative reporting about corruption. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Whereas being a writer is more about how you combine all your research and you mix it with imagination. Usually facts just inspire them. Yeah. Like when I met Pa Umar and Pa Sobron Aidi, they are inspiration, but I wasn't writing about them solely. You see what I mean? Like when I look at the restaurant, I said, look, Pa Umar, I'm going to write a novel, and maybe one day it became a film, because you know when I write, I usually imagine a scene. Usually it's like a scene.
Something filmic.
Yeah, it's always a scene in my mind. So, but I'm not going to write about you as a person. And he understands that. I said, you know, because he married an Indonesian woman, whereas here I said, you know, I wrote that he married the protagonist married a French woman.
French woman.
So I said, you know, you are going to be my inspiration for some parts of your life. For example, Dimas was a journalist who went to Santiago for a conference, and then he couldn't go back home, and that's Umar Said's life. But then after that, it was, you know, it was a totally, you know, fiction.
Right.
So.
And then the language?
Oh, the difference.
Yeah, the language.
Well, obviously, in writing news, you can't be flowery. You know, you have to be more straight. Yeah.
Right.
Of course, Tempo sometimes we were a little bit more. We have more room to have fun with words compared to if you write in a newspaper or online. But still, you're not allowed to be flowery when you write news. Whereas in fiction, in short stories or whatever, you know, you always play with words. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Voor het afscheid nemen wil ik nog even meedelen. Dat mocht er onder u mensen zijn die erg benieuwd zijn naar de roman Pulang en wil liever niet wachten tot volgend jaar, dan kunt u een voorproefje lezen, een gratis voorproefje moet ik zeggen, van een voorlopige Engelse vertaling. Een beperkt aantal exemplaar is gratis verkrijgbaar bij de uitgang van dit theater, bij de stand van Stichting.com. En tevens kunt u daar ook Pulang en de Longest Kiss, Pulang in Indonesisch en de Longest Kiss, is daar ook te koop verkrijgbaar.
Waar is dat?
Bij de uitgang. En is het stand van Stichting.com. Dank u voor de aandacht en tot de volgende.